first book, A Lady or the Man. A Lady or Not the You're Not a Man.
The Man.
And now you're coming on Lady or the Boss. Could you just share a little bit about that book journey to now? What was basically excited you to write that book? What were you thinking then? And what do you expect people to get out of this new second avatar of the book?
So, as you're aware, Sarika, I was very bothered by the fact that in my working career, I would see so many young girls join organizations with great enthusiasm and then not stay there. And I think whether it was you setting up Biz Divas then and Beyond Diversity, etc., or me working with these girls, I think our frustration always was that they are very talented, they're extremely skilled, they come with a lot of aspirations, expectations, and somehow in the first decade of their lives itself, they end up leaving their corporate careers. And I figured out that largely it was because they were not able to manage the balance between work and home. And there was nobody to guide them. So Lady or Not a Man really came out as a more of a practical guide to young women, telling them how to manage this balance, how to have it all in a sense. After I wrote the book, I never thought I'd write a second book because I thought I'd done my job. But the women I had interacted with then grew, as you have grown in your journey, as so many other women have grown. And I realized that the challenges that slightly more senior women face after having worked for, let's say, 10, 15 years are a little different from the challenges that they face when they started off. So the second book really is about those set of challenges. So you've achieved a certain level of success. You've learned to balance woman life, but there seems to be a glass ceiling that women have created of their own making. Apart from, of course, the social biases they face, some glass ceiling that they've created of their own making, some of the ghosts that are residing in their minds. So the second book really is an effort to demystify all those jumbled thoughts that are going through women who have reached a certain level, but they're not pushing themselves to reach the top.
You know, Apurva so rightly said when you said that we are not pushing ourselves to the top, because in many a times, even when I was interacting with women and also in our conversations, it has come out, and also very, very well written in your book in the first chapter, that we tend to maximize our weaknesses more than the strengths. What is the advice you would give to people who are, you know, and as a woman, we always tend to keep saying, ab na ho pai. Things like something new is coming up and you feel start questioning your capability, because I've always seen that, you know, we tend to put only half a hand up for a new opportunity because we're not sure if we are capable to ultimately deliver it. And I've seen men, including my husband and many others, will be like, right out there. How do you deal with that? What would you advise to the women out there to deal with that?
I think the first thing, I don't know whether we are even accepting, acknowledging, or even noticing that we are minimizing ourselves. So as you very rightly said, we don't put up our hand. As you very rightly said, that we are concentrating on our weaknesses. So I know so many women who will, after having done a very decent presentation, will first come back and point out all the places where there's the flaws in their presentation, whereas the guys will think they've done a fantastic job. So even their lack of confidence, so we know that McKinsey report, which talks about that a equally competent woman and a man, if you ask them how many of you think you will reach the top, 79% of the men thought they'll reach the top, 57% of the women thought they'll reach the top. So we innately minimize ourselves, we innately look at our weaknesses, we innately believe that we are not fully ready. Now, what is the solution to this? One is to recognize this, that why am I minimizing myself? Second is to also understand that people around you are projecting a far higher level of confidence than they actually are. So you are as good, if not better, than all the men around you. And indeed, I will tell you as a leader of organizations that at this stage, after having worked for 15 years, 99% of the times a 15-year-old woman and a 15-year-old man, the woman is more competent because she's had to work twice as hard to reach that slot. So I think that recognition that I'm as good, if not better than the man around me, and deliberately teaching our mind to look at our strengths. So it's like, I mean, Sachin Tendulkar, if he always thinks about his bowling, Is he going to go out and do a being the best batsman in the world? So what did he learn? He says, I am a good great batsman. I'll become greater and greater and greater. Unfortunately, we women look at, we may be great, let's say, orators, but we'll concentrate on the fact, maybe I'm not able to write well. We'll be very good in finance, but we'll worry about how poor our marketing skills are, rather than concentrating on our strengths. So the message is, concentrate on your strengths, admire your strengths, acknowledge your own strengths.
And that's the first step, knowing your own strengths and then ultimately enhancing that.
Absolutely.
In fact, Apurva, I remember I was going through a very big crisis in the last few days in terms of making a very crucial decision. And you had told me, just read F1 chapter. And that was a big, I would not like to leave that suspense out. Why don't you share in terms of how F1, which is about setting your priority right, what made you think about that chapter? And what would you suggest to people when they are also trying to recognize their first priority?
I think all of us are intelligent enough to make a list of priorities. We wouldn't have reached this far if we were not clear about our goals, we were not clear about our objectives. But the mistake we often make is, let's say we have a set of 4 or 5 goals. We want to get all of it, achieve all of it, all at the same time. Whether we are running a business, whether it's about a career decision, whether it is about even saying that at this stage, what my first priority is. So to give you a very simple example, especially for younger women out there. So let's say you've just had a small kid, and now you want to spend as much time with your kid. At the same time, you want to do well in your career, and you have bought a house, which is, your office is in Delhi and the house is in Gurgaon. If I ask them, what is your F1? They are not able. They say, I want to work also. I want to be close to, take care of my kid also. I also want to live in my own house. Now you can't have all three, no? So you have to decide what your F1 is. At this stage, when your baby is 3 months and 6 months old, your F1 is to maximize time with your baby. Then everything else should not be priority. So then what you should do is that, instead of staying in my own house, let me put that house on rent. Let me go closer to the place of work, rent a house there for the next 3 years, stay in this rented house. I will reduce time of travel. I'll be able to do a good job at work also, and I'll be able to spend maximize time with my kid. Now, this is a very simple example, but women will spend years not able to reconcile in their mind that currently my F1 is my kid. So that's where you have to make a choice. And often we teach people how to focus. What we don't teach them is how to sacrifice. Because sacrifice is another word for focus, no?
No, but the challenge is that for the many men also, I think there are a few men also into the session. The challenge is that most of the men never had to make these kind of choices. And sometimes the women are faced a lot more in their journey for making these choices. And that's why very rightly said what you know about the F1. One of the questions, Apurva, I would like to ask you is that, have you seen any kind of a leadership mantra which stands true at all times, given all kind of dilemma, which ultimately makes you feel that, you know, jo bhi hoga, achha hoga, this is one mantra, if it stands true, the decision or the dilemma is easily made at that point of time.
Before I answer that question, I want to just stress one more point about this F1 and the choices that you, Sarika, you mentioned, equally for the men in the room. So according to me, F1 is a business principle also. And it's not only, yes, women have to make far more choices, far tougher choices, but it's equally something that men have to deal with, let's say at work, or women have to deal with at work. When in a business, they are trying to prioritize what is my current priority. If I'm an entrepreneur, is what is my F1 currently? Is it about getting that next million downloads? Is it about funding? Is it about becoming profitable, reducing my cash burn? Now, you can't have everything at the same time, but you can say, okay, it's about cash reduction, reducing my cash burn. Then you should not strive for the next million downloads. Then you should say, okay, if I'm okay, if I get 250,000 more downloads, but I will not burn more cash. These are the tussles that we face. And this is where things like F1 come in use, including running a country. So I would give our PM the message that when we were talking about Sabka Vikas, what your F1 should have been Sabka Vikas, which meant that improving the lives of everybody from Mr. Ambani to the junior sweeper outside. So then I would have only focused on how to economically improve the wealth of everybody in the country. And that should have been his F1 rather than the various things that he did. So I think F1 in that sense is a huge leadership mantra, which you also referred to. So I think it's a very important thing.
So well said. And with a tongue in the cheek on that, that was a very chance pay dance comment. Really like that. But yes, moving on to the other thing, I have always read your books at least 2-3 times in the thing. One of the book which, one of the chapter which ultimately resonated very much with me was learning to let go, which is also to a certain extent with your F1. But sometimes, you know, as women, we need to learn and how to take criticism and how to learn to let go or even to negativity around us. And Apurva, I would also, since I know you for some time, I know that you have also dealt with it. I'm sure in the last 30 years of your career, you would have also dealt with it. And in terms of the family, in terms of the work-life pressures, all those things. So could you just share a bit more about that?
When I've talked about learning to let go, I think in lots of manners, both men and women, and especially women, hold on to a lot of past, hold on to a lot of baggage, hold on to a lot of negative things around them because that's status quo. They are comfortable with status quo. See, women have never been taught to rebel, right? Because they've not been taught to rebel, status quo is the most comfortable place they find themselves in, despite the fact that status quo can be negative and toxic. Now, I'll give you 2 different examples. So there was a phase in my own life many, many, many years ago that I was in an organization that was extremely toxic. And there were many positive, as happens in life, there are lots of good things and bad things in one place. But the toxicity of that environment was actually harming my own health. However, there was an upside to it, which was, you know, the position, the perks, the salary, etc., etc. And sometimes you feel that I can't let go of this while you recognize that there's toxicity in the. So I think letting go even of the good things, or in balancing it out and figuring out that these good things, but the negatives are far outweighing the positives. So I have to learn to let go. So it's okay. I can let go of that position because I'm not going to be able to deal with that toxicity. I think people are not able to do that. Log kya kahenge, duniya kya kahegi, if I go from here A to B, suddenly I'm the head of an organization. Suddenly now I'm an entrepreneur. I don't have a business card which says CEO any longer. How will I deal with that? These are the false measures of success that people hold on to. Similarly, you are doing very well in an organization, but there's no growth happening. You may be the best HOD. Everybody is telling you are very good as the HOD, but you are not getting growth. But you are not willing to let go of that comfort. And because you are not letting go of that comfort, that growth will not come. So stability. We look for stability in a job. When you're 35 and 45, you should be looking at growth, no? Yes, at 55, 65, you look at de-risking. At this stage, why are you de-risking yourself? Why are you refusing to fly?
So well said. In fact, I've just wanted to let all the participants know the chat box is open. Please keep questions flying out. While we can keep discussing with Apurva, we would want you also to participate in it. So put your questions out here for Apurva. I mean, Apurva is live out here and completely unplugged. So ask your questions away out here. So Apurva, I wanted to, ask you something. And this is one thing which you must have led that where remote working, or living away from the family, managing a grown-up kid. I know you have a son who has now even done his master's and working and everything. He has flown the nest, rightly so. But you must have gone through that stages of those middle school and the senior school and those, because I have seen a lot of people during our program saying that, oh, my son or a daughter is going through 10th grade, 12th grade. I am not able to give time, and some people take a break. How do you manage? Because people who go with 15, 20 years of experience also struggle with aging parents also struggle with growing up kids going through some very critical decision-making process. How do you manage that? How did you manage that?
I think at any stage in life, and especially, so we women believe that, okay, when our kids are small, that will be the toughest phase. It will become easier. I think there's a phase where it becomes easier, then again it becomes tough because now the kid is in the 10th standard, your parents are aging, you yourself are going through some midlife crisis at that stage. I don't think we recognize the fact we are thinking, because we are used to being caregivers and nurturers, we look at our parents and we worry for them. We look at our children and worry for them. We don't worry about ourselves as much. And I think this phase is also a challenging phase because you are becoming older, you are going through your own midlife issues, etc. So how do you manage that? I think I would say that at this stage again, it's a question of making use of some of the advantages also that come along with reaching middle age. Some of the advantages of being middle age are: A, you have far more help ability financially, you are far more secure. So that ability to say, okay, let me put in some money and have a little more staff at home to help.
That's right.
Let me take up that weekend break where everything is okay at home and go off for a one day sojourn to be with myself. Let me, okay, I can't sit and teach my son everything. Let me organize some, pay some tutor to help him with some subject. Because we are used to doing everything ourselves, at this stage, suddenly when there is some kind of financial stability and security, we don't use our money well.
You know, outsource, as we say, delegate and outsource.
So, and you can, certain things you can't, but then again, prioritize and say what I can do, what I'm good at, where I can help, but everything else you should be able to outsource, no?
In fact, there is this question which is related to this, is that sometimes perceptions, Chetna Bhadwaj writes to us, sometimes perceptions that having a kid would not allow us to take higher, newer roles. How do you suggest managing these perceptions, which are more generalized and not person-centric? These are some of the biases which we have all come across. So Apurva, how would you ask a lady to combat these perceptions?
I totally agree with Chetna that certainly these are the biases. So often I hear, nee, she's just become a new mother. Let's not give her this particular role. How will she manage? And equally questions being asked, now that you're having a baby, will you be able to work? So these perceptions are very much there. My answer is as follows, that it is very difficult to generally change perceptions, but you can change perceptions about yourself. How do you do that? So there are times where if your kid is small and you have to dedicate time to your kid, you'll have to do that. But still 80% of the time you are at work. Let's say you choose to work and your baby is at home. But what I notice is women, when they are at work, they spend more of their time talking about, acha, this is, let me show you a picture of my baby, you know, this. And, you know, so it's called present while being absent. So you're present at work, but you're mentally either thinking about the baby, talking about the baby, talking about family issues. Whereas just observe your male colleague. It's almost as if they're bachelors. They are not going to sit and talk about anything that's happening at home. Either half the time they're not aware, even if they were, they're not going to talk about it. Because at work, they are professionals. And I think that's a very good lesson we must learn from them.
Wherever you are, complete 100% on that front. I have a very interesting question from Vidya, and this is a question which is plaguing almost everybody with changing landscape of the work. When you reach middle age and you realize that you want to upskill, I mean, of course, the whole industry is changing big time. So we learn the theoretical part through a course, but do not have working experience in the same. How do we present ourselves for a job or a project? How do we sell ourselves in such a position? So similar to something, I have not done this before. I might have competencies, but I might not have those requisite experience or skills. So how do you position yourself on this?
So I think first thing, and specifically women, have to first tell themselves in their mind that many times when you move up to another role, to another part of the job, even if you have continued to work and then this upskilling has been part of your job, any new role first is theoretical only, na? You gain experience after doing that role. So why are you again, this is again a weakness that you're concentrating on. we've discussed the point about concentrating on strengths and not concentrating on weaknesses. Now, any new role will be first theoretical only, no? So if I have been an executive and now become a manager. The managerial experience for me was theory. Na? I read, or when I first got into a marketing job, I had read Philip Kotler, but I experienced Kotler while doing my job. No, so I think every role is theoretical to begin with. So why are you thinking of it as a weakness? Point one. Point two is, if let's say it's a technology kind of role where people, let's say your leader or your manager or your new organization expects you to have some practical knowledge, how will you get it unless they give you the job? So I think that's the point that you have to make to them. You have to give me the job, then only I'll do it. Now, secondly, I think there are opportunities to practice that skill by, let us say, applying it for a pro bono job in a NGO. Okay, so now you want to become a social media manager, which is, and you have now, you've theoretically done the course, but you're going and applying in an organization and you're not getting the job. Use that skill while you're upskilling to say, okay, 2 hours I went and did pro bono work for one NGO. So when you're presenting your case, you're saying, I also did the practice of it.
I think this is very important in the sense that how we can actually spread our wings and, you know, practice some of the skills which we are relearning over here in different avenues. It could be in terms of NGOs, startups. Trust me, these guys will lap you guys up with crazy, and you need to just spend a little bit weekends or the evenings, and that's how it happens. So, one of the questions which is coming from Geeta, isn't there a bit of guilt which comes in somewhere when we prioritize the F1 and not able to give desired attention to other aspects? I think we have discussed enough in the fact that F1 is your the priority compared to the other priorities, and therefore we have to let go something which is not so as important on that front. Apurva, I would like to ask one question, and again coming back to the book part of it over here. You spoke about, you know, finding sisterhood, and you spoke about real life role models. And one of the biggest challenge which we all face is that there are not too many role models out there, specifically for women. And of course, finding sisterhood, because there are not too many role models, finding what we call the influential sisterhood, who can actually guide you, mentor you, support you. What is that one mantra you would suggest for these women who are trying to navigate their journeys in their workplace to find that sisterhood, to find that role models out there?
So I think when I use the word sisterhood, I use it a little loosely. I think there are different circles of sisterhood we should try and form. So it's not looking for a sisterhood which is exactly people like you. So, okay, I'm in marketing. Can I find other people at my level, 10 years experience, who are also in marketing, specifically in FMCG marketing, and now create my sisterhood? Like, all of us find circles of support in different kinds of friends, in different kinds of women. So I may find a support in a role model that I admire. I may find support in some of my juniors, because they are my cheerleaders. I may find support in my gym friends, because with them I can go out for a movie and laugh and have fun and forget my work woes. So I think look at sisterhood more as a term which says that I need different types of people around me who will fuel different parts of me. Somebody who shares my hobbies, somebody who likes to watch the same movies as myself, somebody who with whom I can discuss my work issues. I think that's the circle of support I talk about, and as many circles of support you have, the better it is.
Fantastic. You know, Apurva, another thing I would like to ask is that I remember when we had the first discussion and you started sitting onto the boards of Mindtree and other organizations. I remember once you said you were the only woman in the room. And even then, at your level, with your stature, with your experience, you still felt hesitant at times to voice your this thing. And that's an imposter syndrome which all of us face at times. How did you overcome that? And do you still feel things are still remains the same, or have things changed over the years in terms of women in boardrooms, women in leadership positions?
I think The first thing to realize is that imposter syndrome hits everybody. It hits men, it hits women, it hits successful women, it hits non-successful women, older women, younger women. Imposter is something that at different points in time can come up, especially when you are sort of in a new environment, in a new, let's say you've never been a public speaker. You go up and start speaking for the first time, the imposter will hit you there. You are not a social person and you suddenly have to now go out and socialize because your work demands it. Imposter will hit you there. You move from a city to another city and start meeting new people, imposter will hit you there. So imposter will keep on coming and hitting people at different point in time. The way to handle is to first look around yourself and say, whoever the most confident person in the room, it could be Shah Rukh Khan, Amitabh Bachchan, Aishwarya Rai, everybody suffers from imposter. The moment you recognize that, it becomes easier for you to handle. So I'll tell you an anecdote. One of my girls who used to work with me long ago, and she used to be my mentee very long ago. Now she's very senior in some organization. So after she read the second book, she called me up and said, Apurva, why didn't you tell me that you suffer from imposter syndrome? I said, why? The topic never came up, so we didn't discuss it. She said, I wish you had told me that you suffered from imposter syndrome, because when I moved up from my one job to another job, which was a far more visible job in the spotlight, I suffered from a lot of of the syndrome, and my life would have become easier had I known that you have suffered from it.
Oh gosh.
So she says, and this is like 10 years old, 10 years ago. So she's telling me now that I wish, and she actually fought with me. Why did I tell her? So I think whether we tell you or not, whoever it is, you assume that they suffer from it. It will make your life easier.
You wear the mask of the confidence out there and just go out there and slay it. We have Priyanka out here asking a very valuable question. Ma'am, what is it that drives you? That's a question which even I want to know, Apurva. What drives you?
I think what drives me really is, so all of us have goals and objectives, and then one by one you end up achieving them, gives a certain set of satisfaction, then you try and achieve something else. But on a constant basis, what drives me are two things. One is always a desire to become the best version of myself. So I feel that, okay, I have a set of strengths, I have a set of weaknesses. Every day, how can I become better at what I do? So that drives me every day. The second thing is a desire to learn. I'm very, very, I'm a sucker for learning. So I will go, I went last year to Cambridge and did one English course. I will go for seminars. I will do courses on Coursera. I will read new books. I will interact with people. It doesn't matter who they are, how they are, how old, young, etc. As long as I can learn something from them. So I think that these are the two things that drive me.
Fantastic. I have Vidya out here asking this question, again, a question which almost every woman keeps asking us. I've been working for the last 15 years, but somehow have never been able to find a mentor for my career, in spite of trying to find one. So why is it that sometimes we really can't find a mentor, or do I just go with my own intuition and intelligence?
I think a lot of things happen in the universe serendipitously. Okay. Sometimes when we strive and strive for something, we don't get it. Sometimes we don't even strive and we are just, and it falls in our lap. So it is said that a guru will find you. And if a guru has not found you, it means you don't need a guru, Vidya. So my answer to you is that your best guru is your own intuition and intelligence. No. If that's what is with you, they say all I think Raina Milk, Rainer Milke said, the best journey is the one within.
So true.
So inside ourselves, we can't find, I don't have a mentor, for example. I think I'm my own mentor. My own moral compass, my own intelligence is my mentor.
Fantastic. Vidya, I would like to just add on out here. Many a times we feel that we don't have mentors, but when you look around, there are so many go-to people we have. Amongst our friends, amongst our family, there are certain questions which I will plague Apurva a lot. I mean, I never signed her upon as a formal mentor, but she's everything rolled into one for me. Same case, there are certain questions which I go to my family, my brother, some things which I go for my husband, though of course I try to avoid as much as possible. But yeah, all these are different types of mentors, different types of teachers in different ways. And sometimes I've also found it that it's just good to go and ask that, yes, I'm finding a dilemma, or I need some help during this transition. Can you help me through it, to think it through? Sometimes a simple question to ask, and people really like to be in a position to help. I've always found 99% of the time, they generally always reach out and help. So all the best, Vidya. I don't think you really need a mentor, because your intuition and intelligence is the best moral compass, as Apurva mentioned. But no harm in asking for help, and you'll find that help many a times just around you on that front.
Very well said. Very well said.
So we have again one question from Abha. Is it okay to discuss your insecurities? Now, this is a million-dollar question, because sometimes I also face it. Is it okay to discuss your insecurities at work with your colleague or supervisor?
You know, especially as far as women are concerned, I personally am not in favor of discussing insecurities, because they may be true, they may be untrue, but we have this habit, as we have already discussed in this webinar, that we spend too much time focusing on our weaknesses. So, and at work, you have to present a professional avatar. You have to present a look of competence, etc., etc. So I would actually discourage you from discussing insecurities at work.
I also agree with the same thing. I think even if there are some insecurities, it should be all, and in case you have a question to ask, I personally believe that you need to mask it in a way that it is a help which you're looking out for to support you through that journey, rather than discuss it as a weakness or an insecurity at that point of time. Make it as a thing which will help you to perform better rather than a part of your insecurity. But use your girlfriends around for that, guys. Don't use your workplace for that, for surely, on that front. Apurva, I would like you now, you know, from this book, if you could read any of your favorite, I know one of your favorite is the preface. Of course, you could read that, but any other chapter or any particular anecdote which you would like to share from the book?
So my favorite is always the preface or the epilogue. I love, wherever I go, I read the epilogue. But my favorite anecdote from the book is an anecdote about my mom, which I again talk about. So when I wrote my first book, I had dedicated it to her, and it said on the cover, "To Mummy." And when she read it, she says, "Where have you dedicated the book to me?" I said, "But your name, you're right up there." I said, "To Mummy." She's like, "Mummy is there, but where is my name?" So, and so therefore the second book is dedicated to with her name there. But more importantly, I think it drove home a point which is very valid for all of us women, that over a period of time, once we get married and have children, we end up playing different roles. And then we become those roles. Our individuality goes away. So we are mothers, and we are sisters, and we are daughters and daughter-in-laws, but we are, our individuality we have sacrificed somewhere. And then it's so difficult to regain it. It's so difficult to go back to that authentic self, which who, when she was 18, used to enjoy singing or dancing, or because our food habits, our hobbies, our friends all become the hobbies, food habits, and friends of our husbands. I think it's very important to either own our individuality and stay true to it, or if we have somewhere lost it, to try and regain.
Fantastic. Before we ask you to read a chapter or the epilogue as you like it, there's one question from Salma. As women, we are typically loyalists, wherein we deliver more than 100% and would never question or ask for any hike, etc. Why? Why not ask? Wherein we see many men around us, they easily ask, if I am important and critical, what is it that you're doing for me? How do women deal with this?
Again, Sama, very correct. This is a fact. This is a fact that women will not stand up and ask for anything. And we are satisfied with the feeling of being needed. We are satisfied by being complimented. We are satisfied by being loyalists. Men expect some output. If they have been complimented, they say, what do I get out of it? Whereas women are happy with a compliment. I think we have to learn that we are finally here in a professional self. We are working because we are getting a salary for it. And we should demand and expect the same salary as our male colleagues. Why should we get anything lesser? If we are putting in the same effort, the way to handle this is in our minds to not think of our incomes as a second income. Half the reason why women don't ask for a salary hike is because a chief wage earner is our husband. Our income is just the icing on the cake.
Sometimes the insecurity also tries to drive it. I'm not good enough asking for the hike, or I'm not good enough. The responsibilities which will increase with that, it might not be right for my at this stage or age. There's so many insecurities which keeps playing on that front.
Very correctly said.
But if you have to, Apurva, if suppose somebody is getting into negotiation part of it, whether it's in terms of salary or a job role or thing, what is that one or two things you would suggest to keep in mind when somebody is negotiating on this part?
So the, I think one is one definite thing that I teach people as a mechanism to manage this is don't think of yourself. If you're thinking of yourself and saying, oh my God, does Apurva, does Sarika deserve this? Then all our insecurities, all our issues come in place. Just think of yourself as one of your subordinates. Now, if you are the subordinate, you evaluate this subordinate objectively. Once you evaluate that subordinate, so I'm not Sarika. Sarika is my junior. How good is Sarika? Objectively, if I'm able to evaluate Sarika, then benchmark in my mind, this is the value Sarika brings to the table. This is what she should get. Now, if that's a hike, go objectively and ask for it. No, because you have done an objective analysis of what Sarika deserves. Exactly. So when you think of yourself as the third person, sometimes it becomes easier to, or for all you know, you may do a third person analysis and figure out, no, she doesn't deserve a salary hike. She needs
to work differently to get that negotiation out on that front. I always like writing down my points first of what all could be the reasons in terms of doing it and then going out and asking for it, because then you're very crisp and clear. And trust me, if you're especially dealing with some alpha type men, on asking these things, it helps to have those points like point one, point two, point three, point four, and how you are actually not a cost to the company, but actually a productive revenue to the company. So that's could be a way to possibly also look at asking for that print. Apurva, one question I would like to ask is, I'm sure being the CEO of a large company, being on the boards, you're surrounded by men all the time. And sometimes too many gray-haired, too many, I would not call misogynist, but again, very patriarchal set of minds across all over the thing. How do you deal with it in terms of that kind of energy or that kind of vibes which you get it? Or do you, have you ever felt intimidated in that kind of scenario, and how did you deal with it?
So see, patriarchy follows you wherever you are. It is a patriarchal environment and we can't run away from it. And then you get treated in different manners, either misogyny or either then you're not taken seriously, or then you're looked down upon or ignored or talked over. Or I met somebody, a senior industry veteran who said, oh, you're a good girl. So I'm 53 years old, yeah, I'm a good girl. Half the time you can just laugh it off. We have to pick and choose the battles we want to fight, right? Half the time I just laugh it off. A couple of times where I think that it will come in the way of me being seen as competent or otherwise, I make a point of very politely saying that, you interrupted me. I was making a point and I thought that was very rude of you. Can I finish and then you can carry on? So in board meetings, I've done that. I thought it was very rude that you've interrupted me. Can I please finish and then you can carry on? Or, the point that you just made, I had made it 2 minutes ago and I would like to take that point forward before you hijack it. I've said it nicely without raising my voice.
Points get hijacked so many times. You have seen it always on all the time on that front. Okay, great. So I think why don't we have that epilogue of yours?
So I won't read the epilogue. I'll read 1 second. Let me just get the book.
Okay. For everybody, please go and get this book. It is Lady, You're Not the Boss. You've seen the cover out there. And fantastic book, a must read for everyone. As always, Apurva has got some great things. Oh, we have one more question from Vidya. How do you evaluate your worth when you want to negotiate the rewards or remuneration? Men do it easily somehow, but a lot of women struggle about this. Is there a method to this, or do not want to base this on market numbers? I think, Vidya, we just spoke about it. Look at yourself from a person whom you would want to evaluate. Take it as a third person. See if you would have to give a whatever remuneration or rewards or a level change. Would you want to do it to that person? Is he or she valuable enough to the team to get that? If you say yes and tick mark all those questions, possibly yes, that's the right way to do it. And write down all the answers and the reasons behind it, and then go ahead and make a case of it. We just discussed that. Thanks, Vidya, for asking. Apurva, what about the epilogue? Is it the epilogue or some other chapter this time?
I'm trying to figure out. Okay.
I really like the fact that, at every end of the chapter, you have these small, short cheat notes. I call them cheat notes. Yeah, I find it's like, you know, during the exam time, we used to make these short notes to remember the whole chapter in one go. Yeah. And I keep referring to that many a times, even in your first book and even in this book, I always do that.
So it's a very millennial Twitterati generation who can't read a full chapter.
No, but your book has always been a big breeze. So that has always said, you write the way you say, so that makes a difference.
Okay. So I'll just read from the prologue. It will give a sense, people who have not read the book, it will give a sense of what this book is about.
Okay. Sure.
Just a part of the prologue. Okay. It is a fact that even today, despite their stellar achievements, women are still treated as second-class citizens of the world. Whether getting talked over at board meetings or at home, or not getting funding for a startup as brilliant as any man's, or just not getting paid as much as male colleagues, there seems to be a cosmic endeavor to ensure that women remain firmly seated on the substitutes bench and never get to play the match. There is no doubt in my mind that many external prejudices and stereotypes are obstructing your path to glory. However, I believe that there are several mistakes you are making too, which are preventing you from achieving the peak of what you are capable of. It bothers me to see that you still lack confidence and continue to have the tentativeness of a young novice, despite all those certificates of excellence on the wall behind you. It concerns me that you have become fed up of fighting for your rights incessantly and have thus decided to give up on the battle. I watch as you adjudicate poorly on your own behalf by downplaying yourself and minimizing your abilities. As a result, you are fulfilling a mere fraction of your true potential. I know that there is an entire universe inside you, waiting to be discovered. But I see you sitting at the edge of your seat, always afraid that someone may throw you out of the room because you believe that you're an imposter who will get caught one day despite your accomplishments. But here's the truth. Unlike Cinderella, you're not going to turn back into a beggar maid at the stroke of midnight. You have genuinely worked hard to reach here. You rode to the ball, not in a carriage conjured out of thin air by a fairy godmother, but in the car you bought with your own hard-earned money. You did not need a fairy godmother to get you thus far, but you do need someone to tell you that you definitely deserve to be here and that there are vast and unconquered opportunities still ahead of you, because the one single unassailable truth is that your best version is yet to come. For that to happen, however, there is only one magic wand, and it is firmly in your own hand. When you realize that only you can prevent yourself from being condensed or minimized. When you read this book, you will realize that it invites you to reflect on what you have achieved so far, the restrictions you have imposed on yourself, and how you have many times swayed to a tune not of your own making. By adjusting and accommodating, by choosing to keep quiet, and by allowing yourself to drift. As you reflect, I hope you will recognize that the time has come for you to decide for yourself what you want to do. And this time around, you get to choose what you want. Just remember that your prospects are limitless and infinite, and they will take you wherever you want to go. Rumi, the patron saint of the Twitterati, says, "Are you a drop in the ocean or the ocean in the drop?" Lady or the Boss is for women who believe that no boundaries should curb them, no shackles should bind them, and no barriers should come in the way of what they can truly achieve. I hope this book gives you the courage to dance to a tune of your own making and pushes you to the furthest limits of your potential in your adventures at work.
This is so beautiful. In fact, you know, it reminds me of two lines. Being a typical Bollywood fan, I always like the fact that the way you said, you know, you be the heroine of your own story. And if I have to go back to one of the favorite characters from Kabhi Khushi Kabhi Gham of Pooh, saying my apni favorite hu. Uh-huh. And these are the two lines which is right now resonating in my mind that just remember this. I'd still see a couple of questions, Apurva. We'll just take these couple of questions before we wrap up. We have just finished around 45 minutes. We have these couple of questions, last 10 minutes. Being alone, Priyanka says, being a lone woman in an all-men team, I do have the support from my boss. However, I see that my peers in the team are either jealous, uncomfortable, backbiting me when I take additional responsibilities aiming for higher positions. How is she better than us? Is she not as capable as us, etc.? Though I appear to shrug it off, back of the mind, I'm disturbed. Sometimes get loose morale. how to come out of this?
So Priyanka, the fact is that constantly there'll be somebody who's backbiting, especially when women are competent, when women are doing well, when women are successful, because people have not seen that role, right? They've seen women as either unsuccessful or sitting at home. So when you are actually shaking the status quo when you are being different from the rest of the typical women. So my answer to your question is this will happen. You are fortunate that you have support of your boss. Many of us didn't get that support. So you are fortunate that you've got concentrated on the fact that your boss supports you and ignore the rest of people. I'll tell you, wherever you are, whatever you are doing, there will be some people who will be trying to pull you down.
Priyanka, this is a part and parcel of corporate life. I feel this kind of a politics, regardless of the fact it's a woman or a man, they all face these kind of challenges, sometimes a little more in degree, sometimes a little less in degree. And as Apurva ma'am said, we need to shrug it off at times and just move ahead and just surge ahead in that front. So all the best, Priyanka. As they said, you are heroine of your own story, so create your own story out there. Shalini writes to us over here, when will we get to see a few chapters? And Shalini, I know we have those chapters, but Apurva will tell more about it. When will we get to see a few chapters which covers the challenges and stories of single women, not necessarily single parents, who are ambitious and have reached senior roles or aspire to be?
Shalini, the good news is that today there are so many women in whether as entrepreneurs or in the corporate world who are single and very proudly single. I myself have more of my friends who are single than women who are married. And, you know, I see how they are managing, to navigate this space. And I'm extremely proud of them. I'm extremely proud of knowing them. Lady or the Boss has a chapter and several stories about single women and how they are navigating the path. Not single parents, single women. And how they are managing to navigate this whole...
I love this chapter. All the single ladies.
And let me tell you that many married friends of mine are very envious of the single women.
Trust me, we all are.
One quick anecdote I'll tell you. So I met a single woman friend of mine and her father's 82 years old. And that day, he's telling me, at 82, Nidhi, I'm actually glad that you didn't get married. When I see your friends and I see how unhappy they are, I'm quite pleased that you chose to remain single.
So anyways, until you find the right partner, it's always very single and good to remain like that. So we have a chapter in this book. Do read it. And of course, as Apurva ma'am suggested, there are a lot of stories and anecdotes from here. And they are quite rocking ones. So Apurva, any last words before we, you know, wrap this up? Anything, any last advice or suggestion you would give to all the women out here?
When I talk to senior women, the one thing I tell them that I myself have seen how much you have struggled to reach where you are. You have balanced many things. You have listened to a lot of negative backbiting from people, but still you have reached this position. This is a hard won battle. Now, at this stage, don't let go. You still have another level to cross and another padhav, as they say in KBC, to go over. You're just as 3 lakhs. You have to reach that 10 lakh padhav and the 1 crore padhav. So don't give up. You have it in you to reach right up to the top of your career.
The good news is that you have almost covered the 2/3 of the journey. It's the last 1/3 of it, which is going to be the most rocking one. So just stick around for it. Last question. Any tips on writing a book? Now, this is a question which even I want to know. I've never been able to do this. This is the second book you got out of it with your really hectic, work and life. So how did you manage this?
As in everything, I think... to achieve anything, you have to practice. Don't assume that one day you will get up and you will be able to write a whole book. A book has 55,000 words. Yeah, it has 30 chapters. So you're not going to be getting up one day and the book will just flow seamlessly from you. So the way to do it is to first start writing. Write one page, write a blog, but write regularly. Write an article, write a diary if you want. But start writing regularly and repeatedly. Over a period of time, the book will naturally emerge.
So like anything, persistence and consistency is what ultimately is required. So thank you so much, Apurva. As usual, it's such a pleasure chatting with you, and every moment when it passes, it doesn't realize so fast. And we love having you out here, and we all, I mean, we are getting some fantastic reviews over here, very inspiring, really admire you. I think you have been an inspirational person for all of us, and we look forward to your continued support and guidance to all the women, and look forward to hearing on a third book soon as well. And for all the people, please do read the book, Lady, You Are the Boss. I think one of the best sellers in this year. You must read it. And there's a very nice video, which I'll ask Nancy to share it with all the people, which Apurva had made, which kind of gave the whole essence of the book in a very short, nice video, in a very nice Joomla style. So I love that video. We'll definitely share it with you soon. Thank you so much, Apurva. And look forward to have the continued guidance from you.
Thank you, Sarika. Thank you for
all the best. Bye, everyone. Have a great evening and a great week ahead. Bye.
Bye.